meeting to order. Merry Christmas, everyone. Happy New Year's. Happy Hanukkah. Glorious Kwanzaa. Let's see, Ugly Sweater Day. Enjoy Ugly Sweater Day. And if you're more excited about Star Wars coming out, may the force be with you. Hopefully, we got a good time.
You can't sing Dingle Bell.
Well, no, I can't sing period.
There you go. You can't hum Dingle Bell.
We've got a pretty full agenda of things going on today, so we'll roll on in. We may have to juggle around a few things, but first order of business is public comment. We've got several guests with us today. Anyone have anything they'd like to share with the board?
I wanted to give my list for my contracts last week that we requested.
Thank you very much. Anyone got anything else? We can't get a Merry Christmas out of you this morning.
Yeah, Merry Christmas.
Thank you very much.
And I hope everybody has a Happy New Year.
All right, we're hoping to have an executive session, but we're waiting on our legal representatives. So let's roll into the meat of the agenda. We'll come back and pick that up. So in your package is the minutes from the last meeting. What's your pleasure?
Make a motion to approve those.
Second that.
Motion and second. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Minutes stands approved. Roll right into financial report. Amy, get us started.
Okay, everyone should have received the financial statements as of November 30th. And just a couple of things to point out.
You get my back.
Okay, there was a couple of adjustments that weren't made at June 30th that were subsequently sent to the auditors that related to post-employment benefits for health insurance and then the liability for the closure and the post-closure. Both of those have been made in these financial statements, so when we get to the auditors presenting their report, then you'll see the numbers as far as the net position agree with that. Also, if you look at the income statement, just to point out a couple of things, repairs and maintenance on equipment was up. We had a couple of significant repairs that we incurred in November to the couple pieces of equipment. That was just over $12,000. But still for the month, the net increase of $58,268 for the year.
Closure went up $800,000. Am I reading that right?
No. Okay.
Just tell me what the number is. Ed. You mentioned it. But
for the current year, it went up. The prior year number was not adjusted at that point to the audit. I think we did that in December. So I think it was $400,380.
Okay,
you'll
so
see
that
5853
is not correct.
Not as of last year's audit, no. It was 350,
though. Okay. Which is lower than it's been significantly, isn't it?
It is some lower.
600,000.
June 30, 16 is 410. So hundreds of thousands, no.
410,000?
Yes. 410 for year end 16, okay. And 350 for year end 17. If anybody has any questions, I'll be glad to.
Help me with that one more time. There is a difference on this of 760,000 approximately. So we're 410 and what?
350. Okay. But the number that's on your in-house, I'll say, financial statements as of last year, the prior year.
About that. I'm talking about today.
I know, but I'm just trying to explain why there's a bigger difference there than.
I'm just saying, so that, Between those 2 years, it's $706,000.
Yes.
All right, anything else on the financials?
Keep rolling.
I just wanted to kind of touch back at something Doe asked at last meeting on the engineering costs. I did do a breakdown year to date of what some of those costs represent. And through November, we were at $120,000, and almost $33,000 of that relates to sampling that they've done. $15,000 is related to the potential expansion. $30,000 related to closure, and almost $26,000 relates to the recycling station. So, just for your information.
$26,000 on recycling.
Mm-hmm. Now, some of that will get capitalized at the end of the fiscal year, but
the day we didn't use it.
So.
Okay. Thank you.
For information.
What else do you have for us, Amy? Anything? There's some other things in your email. I want to do that later.
Well, I can do it whenever now or unfinished business.
Well, what do you got?
Okay. If you recall, at last month's meeting, I presented a proposed bad debt policy. And after some discussion, we made some amendments to that proposed policy to reflect the changes requested. And that was sent to you in the packet yesterday as well. And basically, it was to cut customers off from charging after 60 days and turning them over to collection after 120.
We need a motion to approve that.
We do.
I'll do back that motion. 60 and 120, right?
60 and 120. We got a motion, we got a second. Any discussion? All in favor of the debt policy is presented, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We have a revised bad debt policy.
I think that's it for me.
Well, why don't you introduce our auditor in the report?
Okay. You can postpone that just temporarily.
Well, we're waiting, you know, I'm juggling already. You can't throw me 2 minutes.
We're waiting on the auditor in the report.
This is the auditor. Auditor.
That's right. You can't speak from memory about all our wonderful auditors.
Oh, we can talk about it. Yeah. You just don't have anything in front of you to look at.
That's the best. You can't be questioned.
No. We'll be quiet.
No questions.
They are on the way.
Okay. We'll defer audit. We got two in the wings waiting all day. All right, Dan,
you're not charging us for this delay of that y'all caused.
It isn't me.
No,
it's
a
good
thing.
All
right, Dan, what you got?
As far as the December PDAC inspection, there is some discrepancies in it. I think he must have been in a hurry. They no longer issue them on site. They email them to you. He's got the Lakeway landfill address on here, Highway 160. He's got the county of Knox, but the rest of the report is, and there's one other note in here about the head on the liner, and he's got 28 inches. We have no way of proving that. That's what they've asked us to do. So those are the inconsistencies that are incorrect. As far as the note at the bottom of it, we had received some material that was requestable from the Inca plant over there, and I contacted him, and he had made note of it on the bottom of our inspection, and we shut him off because it was questionable material. And they have met with the contractor over there working to resolve the issue.
Do you know if that's resolved? I've not heard any follow-up.
Unless I get a letter from the state, it's not going to work. We cannot do anything with it. So until they permit it, or whatever they decide to do, or whatever they permit it to, it may go to the other landfills. But
okay, I know that I get set in my ways easily and quickly, but these new reports are a little harder to wade through. I guess we'll get accustomed to it. But it is what it is. Okay, what else you got?
So the next thing, as far as Dozer, we've had some serious breakdowns here in the last month or so. Had track failure, had to do a major repair here this month. I would strongly recommend to the board that we need to consider updating our Dozer, you know, 3 to 4 months out, if you choose so today to order one or choose a Dozer to order. So that would put us March, April, maybe even late April.
If we had to rent one, it'd be April before we could get it?
If you rent one, they rent for 10 grand a month.
And that's that?
Pardon?
I said, when would we get it? If we had to rent a machine, it'd take 4 months to get it?
Correct. They build.
To rent a machine, they build a machine to rent?
No, you won't get that, you won't get that machine to rent. That's why you won't put that machine in trash. That would be just for cover. They'll pull you one off the lot down there, a used one or a trade-in, because they don't want to put their new machines in there.
But if we rented one, when could we get it? Next week, a month from now?
If we would have to get a backup Dozer in to replace the one we've got to rent, is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
They get you one in a week?
But it's not with the trash. Yeah, we couldn't put it in the garbage.
Yeah.
And what would you do if you need one put in the garbage if you can't rent one?
That's the problem. The part is why we rent anything, you can't do it with garbage.
It's covered with.
That's the only thing.
And that's all you can do.
Yeah, it's covered with, that's correct.
So, we've got three proposals, I see?
Yes. Also, they've included the lease on two of them, there's lease options in there on two.
What's your recommendation?
My recommendation would be the cat for a couple of reasons. One is the direct drive, not having the hydrostatic. The other is the top drive being up higher. You're able to catch stuff before it goes in and tears out the seals, whether it be cables or barbed wire or just wire and all. I know it's considerably more expensive, but that is the big advantage with the cat versus the others.
Why are those others had to come to that high drive?
If I can, I had to do that. I was asked 3 or 4 months ago if I had a preference, and I answered honestly, no, I don't. But then I got to thinking about what it's doing. And I have contacted 6 different landfills around us, and there is no other machine that is built more protected than a cat. If none of the final drives on the other 2 machines are protected as well. And if you lose one final drive, you've almost got half the cost of the difference in price. And in the past, we had machines without that protection, and we've lost final drives every 4, 5, 6 months that reseal them.
Yeah, I guess, all right, we've got in the proposal lease purchase, but it'll help me out. Capital leases require approval by comptroller's office.
It's considered a debt.
So that would be a debt issue. So we're going to go that route. There's additional time just for paperwork approval. Is that fair to say? So if you want to go that route, we need to fill that in the time.
Tom's got some information on as far as the difference between lease and purchase as far as time-wise goes, the money.
I mean, the only thing I did, I sit down and kind of put the pencil to the budget. The lease options all have finance rates built into them, so it looks like every option you go with would cost more over the long term, and if the only benefit we would have to lease a machine would be if we plan to keep it 36 months or less. So I guess a lot depends on how long do we think we're going to need the machine.
Well, who's proposed the lease?
John Deere had proposed 4 different.
We're not going to buy that one right next.
And Caterpillar proposed a lease option.
Looks like about $100,000 more for the lease option.
If I'm reading it right, we would have $447,000 in that machine if we leased it and kept it.
And then at the end of the day, you have nothing. versus if you,
well, if you purchase it, you have.
That would be a buyout.
You own it.
That's with a balloon buyout.
No, you own it.
So it's a capital lease, so you would own it at the end of the lease, but you're gonna have $447,000 in it versus $379,000.
All right, so we've got quotes on the floor.
We did the state bid, it's quite often the highest, not the lowest. Would it be, of course, you'd be on the way you bid it. Nobody from CAT can come into this area other than Establish. That's just the CAT's franchise agreement. But I'm not, just because it's a state bid contract doesn't mean it's the cheapest, trust me. We did it the other day on a tractor, and it's what, $25,000 difference, which represented 20%. I don't know what's on this one.
So how do you get a competing price?
Did you request for quotes instead of the state bids? Does that have that work?
I think that's what we've done.
What kind of, but it wasn't obviously what a Caterpillar machine you're talking about, the tractor.
Well, there again, they protect their.
Right, that's what I'm saying. I don't know if you're gonna get them
over here. Right, I don't know, and that's why the damn price is that high.
I don't think we'll get a competitive price, do you?
I like the way you said that. You're exactly right. I agree with that. You don't get a competitive price.
So we need a motion to buy it. I make the motion, we purchase the machine and get over with.
Caterpillar.
It's been on the floor for 3 months.
Caterpillar.
Yes, sir.
I second.
All right, got a motion to second, purchase the Cat. Any other comments?
The only disappointing thing I have is that this was brought, we did a budget 5 months ago, and there wasn't a damn word mentioned about the machine. And then, so let's go with our 3 months. So 2 months after we've approved the budget, now we need $400,000, whatever the number is. It's gone down $67,000 to the original price we had on the Cat was $425,000 or something like that, I believe, wasn't it? Does anybody know? Yeah, it's pretty close. It might have been $396,000. It's $30,000 or $40,000 more than what this price is. And I think we need to manage it a little better than what it is being done as far as equipment maintenance or whatever it is.
All right. Other comments, Mike?
I would agree that the Cat machine is the way to go. My question is, you know, with the different studies we have, are we going to be in the landfill business as we are now in 2 years or 5 years or whatever? That seems to be the decision even ahead of the purchase of the machine today. We obviously need a machine.
I think that's a reasonable question. Unfortunately, we've not done the analysis to get back to the report, and it's probably not coming even in January, so we're kind of rocking a hard place.
But how much did we spend on the machine in December, or have we spent this month?
We spent $17,900 on that machine this month.
What was it for?
Track repair.
What is the warranty on the Caterpillar?
5 year, 5,000 hours, I believe. I think it's in
there. Yeah, you usually.
They run out of warranty.
About
2 years, because we average 2,000 hours a year on that machine. That and the compactor, your two leading machines.
Tony, I do believe there's an option under the lease that if the board elects not to include it in the budget for some reason, there is an option to. Yeah, out of the lease at no cost, if I read that correctly. Something to consider as well.
Well, we're at a point where we need to make a decision without complete information. That's unfortunately where we find ourselves. We have a motion on the floor and a second to purchase the Cat. Given the magnitude of the decision, I think it would be appropriate to call the roll. Let's call the roll.
Mike Mayo?
Yes.
Bob Garrett?
Yes.
John Hofer?
Yes.
Keith Jackson?
Yes.
Louis Jarvis?
No.
Matt Lacy?
Yes.
Tom Rush?
Yes.
So, Dan, you need to get us rolling on. Getting the order in place. Hoping we get this right. That's all that's on your list, Dan. You got anything else you want to too long to follow the judge on the floor.
A lot of my following engineering report, what we've been working on, so we'll carry it over there.
Let's turn it over to LDA and talk about engineering.
We've been working on a lot lately. We did, I think in the meeting minutes, had the groundwater report from the 2nd of, I believe it was October when we did that. Had a few things didn't come back so great, so they're going to keep us in. It's still a biannual, but it'll be the tier one, tier two. Basically, the analysis part will be an increase. It'll be still significant, about half of what 2016 was. So we're still in a good boat there. Then we've got Steve had a sit down meeting with TDEC on the 7th, and they discussed part of the TDEC reports have been the storage plan, TDEC requirements to be able to monitor the depth of leachate on the liner, and also be able to, in the term store for 30 days, storage for 30 days is a tank larger than anybody, well, larger than the land that we got down there. So we talked them into storage for 3 days and being able to maintain with a pump truck for the 30 day span, and they've agreed to that, so that should help out on tank cost, storage cost. We've been working on the closed section of the landfill. There's a few leachate issues on that side. Gas monitoring has been kind of high on that side too. All that's probably working together, so we've been working on a plan to put a new leachate French drain per se in. We don't want to go into the landfill, but we'll keep it outside for a new, everything that's there is collapsed right now, so we're working on a plan for that. Goal is to have this thing wrapped up and out to bid January. We've been with the groundwater monitoring. Back in April, we were relieved of two of the monitoring wells that are out there. One of them is in pretty bad shape, so we haven't been able to monitor it. You've got an excessive amount of monitoring wells out there, so they've allowed us to remove two of those. We've been working with Geotex on that. Hopefully in January, we'll get those things pulled out, sealed off, and get TDEC happy with that. MUS, the pre-treatment industrial waste, we've been working with them. We're finding quite a bit of information that the equipment that they're speccing, it's going to be very difficult to find anything that matches that. So we're going to start working with suppliers to get quotes on the flow monitoring that needs to go in place for that and get that sent over to you all probably in January. We do have an extension to get that plan in place. With that, we've also been discussing with MUS the ability to pull off the sanitary sewer that flows down to there. Our biggest concern is where the flow meter sits right now. You're probably getting a lot of eye and eye that's running through there. So you're paying sewer bills on, you know, surface water that's getting through manholes. You're also getting samples of whatever's coming off the road and stuff like that. So we're fixing to submit a request to remove the upper portion, which would just be restrooms for the sake of the landfill. Dennis and I worked on finding the valves and stuff for the baler building, and there's already tanks in place for those to run into. So we should be able to remove all of that. Hopefully that'll reduce quite a bit of flows going through there. So we're only going to be, as far as the industrial pre-treatment stuff, focusing on the leachate that's leaving the landfill itself.
before you leave though, we were trying to see if there's a part we can buy from the existing flow meter to meet the spec. Is that not gonna work?
I don't think that's gonna work, because the flow meter that's in place right now, it reads an elevation. If you get something that stops in front of it and the water goes over it, you're increasing your flows, you know, and may not even notice it. So the stuff that they expect is really it's a laser flow meter that allows them more accurate, doesn't have, you know, as much error that can be placed into the system. So we were wanting to try to just fix what was there, but with everything that they're wanting it to do, futuristic and stuff, that we're still looking at other options, but I don't think that's going to be the case. The landfill alternative analysis, Steve's been working with Joey Bernard. I'm not sure exactly who that is. He's got some cost estimates over to him.
Joey works under my backhand pretty well, and unfortunately that is moving slowly. We did get the numbers late, but I had indicated we'd try and have that for the next month. We probably won't have it in February.
Okay. Also, during Steve's meeting on the 7th with TDEC, they discussed the closure. Got some feedback on that. We're working to finish up the closure plan. Steve's goal was to have it done early January. I think still to try to meet the, get some closure work going in March, April.
We were actually scheduled to a closure for this year, and we were in the process of writing a letter to that Crystal Spring for the flood restoration.
Yes. And then I kind of alluded to the flow on the leachate, and Dan alluded to it on the TDEC is wanting to know how much leachate head is standing on the liner, so we're working with some suppliers to try to find some cheap solutions that are effective enough for TDEC to approve on measuring that. Right now, today, talking to TDEC, there's nobody in the situation that the landfill is that has found a way around this. Typical landfill's got a sump in it. This particular landfill does not. So monitoring this depth is going to be a little tricky.
What difference does it make?
What's that?
The amount of leachate that's in the bottom of the line.
The state's requesting that no more than a foot of leachate be on the liner, just to protect the seams in the liner is the big issue there.
Let's say there's 2 feet. What do you do?
Well, then if we do prove that there is over that 1 foot, then we're going to be looking at the flow going out. Is there some clogs or something like that? Is there some plastic pipes that are there that we need to fix? And it's obviously rain can play a big part in how much water stands on it. So what they want to see is if it does go above it, how quick does it get back off of it? So is the system able to do what it's supposed to do? But if you got a backup in the line, and you got a backup into the landfill, which pushes it out the liner, and I think that's the big thing you're wanting to get off of.
Okay, any questions or comments on the report? Concerns? Dan, what else we got? Unfinished news. We got some
new business. I can't get found here. We've got some surplus equipment, mainly implements. For instance, when we sold a tractor and replaced it, or traded a tractor in on the bar, we have a disc and bush hogs and spreader box. And there's a couple other things there, but those are basically implements that are for equipment we no longer have. I'd like the board's permission to auction those things off in February's auction and white pack.
Okay.
I'll make the motion.
Second.
Motion second, any other comments? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Let's get them sold. Anything else, Dan? Let's circle back around to the top and talk dollars and cents.
If you don't know, these are your auditors. Tanya Easley and Curtis Morrison.
Morrison, yes.
With Renfrew Moss, and they've been your auditors, so you should know them. Tanya's been here at least every year. Curtis maybe all. I'll turn it over to them. This, what you have is a draft, but we do not anticipate any changes. Other than you'll notice the dates on your draft report aren't completed. There are X's, but on the released report, there will be.
There will be actual dates in there. Anyway, I want to go ahead and start. As you said, I'm Curtis Morrison. As we put together these financial statements, I thought I'd hit some more significant items and things that you would be concerned with. On page 2 and 3, you'll find that is our opinion on these financial statements, which in this case is what's called an unmodified opinion, which means that we believe they're materially correct. Just wanted to kind of point that out. That's really our only page. The rest of it is yours. But beginning on page 4 is management's discussion and analysis. And that's, if I was going to read just a few pages, that's where I would start. That's kind of just a very broad overview with just a little detail on what's actually, what you're reading in numbers is actually more verbiage on what's happened. And that's important to keep in mind as you go through here. And that's on pages 4, 5, and 6. But I will go to the page 7, which is the statement of net position. And I'll point out a few things that it's definitely worth paying attention to. If you look at cash between 2016 and 2017, there's a pretty significant difference of roughly $1 million. Well, if you look down in investments, there's also an increase there. So what's really happened is those have been moved to investments to get some earnings on those so that it's not idle cash, which is a good move. Further on down the page, you'll see deferred outflows of resources. That's your pension. And I would point you to page 17 at the bottom. That'll give you a lot of detail on what's in that $110,000 and what happened between the 53 and the 110. And that's all via actuaries and people who are really into numbers figure that stuff out. I'll point out that as you've already noted, the accrued closure and post-closure care costs did change roughly $350,000, and you'll note that that's the difference between 2017 and 2016. And down at the bottom, the most important thing is your total net position has changed from $335,000 to $652,000, which is an increase of roughly $320,000. Keep in mind that the vast majority of what you have in position is in your fixed assets. That's why you see unrestricted a negative balance on here, is because basically everything, your value is in your fixed assets. And that's the highlights on the net position. And I know everybody has already seen the income statement prepared, and there's just a few changes that she noted earlier. For the year ended June 30, 2017. And that's on the statements of revenues, expenses, and changes in net position on page 8. Year over year, operating revenues, were increased roughly $200,000, while at the same time, total operating expenses decreased around $60,000. So you have a pretty significant operating income versus the prior year loss
change of $330,000.
And then the other financing sources, you'll note on here, interest income of those are roughly the same. However, we did sell some capital assets during the year, and your proceeds on that was $21,000. So at the end of the day, as I mentioned before, you added to your net position $317,000 year over year versus a loss in the prior year of $17,000 to get to where you are now. I won't go through page 9, that's just cash flows. That's just letting you know where you spent your cash. So you can see how those, where those changes came from. And then you can read through the notes on pages 10, 11, 12, pretty much all the way to the end. All the way through page 20, that gets longer and longer every year. Page 21 is a required supplemental information, and it deals with your net pension liability. And in your case, you're one of the lucky few, your total pension liability has been relatively consistent year over year. We're now up to 3 years, and as this goes, it'll be up to a total of 10 years, showing you any changes in that as it goes. And those numbers are calculated by actuaries via the state or otherwise, and there's not a lot of changes you can personally make or as a business do to affect these numbers, other than unless you have some sway with the stock market and get better returns on that. So page 22 is just a continuation of that. It just gives a little detail of what your contributions were and what they said recommended for you, and you've made all the recommended contributions. Continuing on to page 23 is also the post-retirement welfare plan funding progress. These are all required schedules that just let you know the status of it year after year after year. And then the final two pages are another report. The first being page 24. That's our report on internal control over financial reporting and on compliance and other matters. As part of a regular audit, we look at internal controls and certain compliance matters. While we don't give an opinion, we certainly do let you know if we find any deficiencies. And in your case, it's a very short letter. It's only a page long that tells you that we didn't find any deficiencies or any compliance issues. And I think that's important to point out. And the very last page is summarizing the prior year notings and findings, and you'll see that last year in 2016 there was a finding for purchasing, and that has since been corrected. We didn't find that repeating again in the current year. I tried to summarize that really quick, but feel free to ask me any questions.
Give me that last. What was it?
They have, you all implemented a purchasing policy, but the purchase orders that were being done, sometimes it would say what they were purchasing, but it wouldn't necessarily have a dollar amount for what they, how much they were going to spend. Sometimes the purchase purchase orders weren't dated, sometimes they weren't being signed, etc. So, but they have corrected that, and they have purchase orders now that are being, have dollar amounts, and they are being signed and approved and dated.
Page 22, where it has contribution as a percentage of covered employee payroll. Is that what our contribution is to TCRS per employee?
Yes.
The 12.72%.
Yes, sir.
And really, I'll point out, Curtis mentioned you can't really manipulate these numbers. The only true way you could would be to commit yourself to a higher contribution percentage.
Now, I would say a higher return percentage.
We could. General Motors did, and they went bankrupt.
Didn't work out too well.
Our employees, they're contributory, the 5%.
And I will point out, for those of you who may not be that familiar with TCRS, Tennessee is one of the best funded plans in the United States. Tennessee has actually done a very good job making sure that they're funded where other states are nowhere near or billions and hundreds of billions short. Tennessee is fine. So we're very fortunate.
A couple of things that really jumped out at me. First is clearly increased sense of strength in that position is step in the right direction. And this will be the first report since we've brought the new engineering firm on board. The engineering estimate is reflected in the report. Is that an accurate statement? So we're getting a clearer, cleaner picture of what we've got, and we're getting a handle on the way we're managing our cost. Any other questions or comments about this report? If we didn't have retirement, we'd be about a third the size.
You'll have the final to us when? No, I'm just saying so we can get it. It had to be submitted to the state by the end of this month.
Yeah, I could get it submitted to the state today.
Yes. Well, but they have said it'll be dated and in front of us next month.
Oh, yes.
Accepted. Does that make sense?
They'll send me an electronic copy like they submit to the state, and I'll email that out to all of you.
And then the bound copies, we'll get those to you next week.
Yep. So it would be next month, right, Chairman, before we could accept it?
Right. This is a draft report. I assume there's no changes anticipated, but yeah. Formally accepting it needs to be a final report. Is that fair statement?
Well, I want one of the day. I don't care what date it says.
X is good today, isn't it?
You
not
can,
for me, unless it's got an extra and triple X.
You can give them authority to issue.
Yeah, I think that's...
That would require a motion.
So do we need a motion for that?
Yes.
For what?
For them to issue the report.
Make that motion.
Okay. Motion second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. I'm doing a little bit of fill on waiting for Mr. Capps to show up. I've got an unavoidable conflict next month. So, Tom, if you would be willing and able, I'm going to ask you to chair next month's meeting. And as I said earlier, I'd hope to have the analysis of options for moving forward prepared next month. Obviously, I'm not just going to hand that to you and let you do that. So we'll try and schedule that in February. I had considered the idea of trying to have a call meeting for that purpose, but the amount of time between when it's going to be ready and the February meeting doesn't make a lot of sense. So that's kind of the game plan there. Anything else that you'd like to bring to the table while we're waiting for Mr. Capps? Mr. Capps comes on the queue, but anything else before Mr. Capps begins to speak? All right, Chris, while we're preparing here, I've asked our attorney to come give us a little briefing on some outstanding legal issues, and that would be appropriate to go into executive session.
That would be appropriate for executive session.
So I would ask for a motion to enter into executive session for a brief moment.
Second.
Motion second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed. All right, we're going to executive session. I do not anticipate doing anything once we come out other than adjourning, but if you want to hang around and watch that, you're welcome to do so. We need to clear the room here for adjournment.